I've been working with George for many years, and we worked on this book together, which you'll see pedestal over there, George Wardlaw, Crossing Borders, and it covers George's career up through paintings that he did of Maine, beginning at the beginning of his career with the metal work that he was doing and jewelry, and then up to about five, well, 6 years ago. And so definitely, you know, take time and take a look at the book. I think there's extra copies around that we brought up and left here at the department so that you can look back and see, because what I think you'll find in looking through the earlier work, and we'll talk about it today, of how that actually comes into the most recent work. How George is really mining his own imagery that he's created over a long career of painting, and how it comes together in his current work. So this exhibition is of recent work, but the way we hung the exhibition, these two paintings here are from 2 years ago, and this work is a year ago on this wall, and these two works are the most recent works. And knowing George's work very well, having watched him create this work, and he's quite prolific, we could definitely do a second book, because there's enough work for another book. It's really interesting to watch how he goes from one series to the next, and how we get from one series to another, and to watch this development process in the work. So I guess the first question is to ask you to talk about these works that are on exhibit.
First, I would like to say thank the school here, and especially Budge, who saw my work down in Amherst and invited me to show the work up here, and which I am greatly appreciative of. I'm very familiar with the school here since I was chair of the art department at the university for 17 years. So we worked and we accepted a lot of students from the school here. And there's one thing we could always depend on: the quality of the student work coming from this school. And that speaks very well, I think, of the faculty here. The first work that I would like to speak about, first of all, I would like to say that it was an interesting experience to me last week coming to this room, especially with Lori, and she curated the work that is being shown here. And I had the pleasure of sitting over there, keeping my mouth shut, and watching her almost like a painter, moving things around, like the paintings were like collage. And she'd move it here, she'd move it over there, and she'd say, "That looks pretty good." And she'd stand back there for a while, then she'd start moving it again, and then again. And this was the final arrangement that she had. And I found it intriguing how closely allied making decisions about work and exhibiting it is very much like creating the work itself. And you did a great job.
Thank you.
So what I'm going to talk about first is the first group of the works here. It's called Evolution's Spirit One. The one word that describes evolution's spirit series is conglomerate. I thought I knew what conglomerate was until I looked it up. And this is what I found was the definition. Conglomerate is a number of different things or parts that are placed or grouped in a form, a whole, and remain distinct entities. I think a perfect example of that is right behind me. The shapes in here are all different from each other. If you're looking for identifications of something outside the work, you're probably looking for the wrong thing. The work here does not make reference to any particular things or particular objects, etc. Except when I make a mistake and worldly things creep in. The paintings in this series are all related and function somewhat like chapters in a book. Other than shapes, the major components or performers are color, size, surface, interaction, and organization. And each of the aforementioned items play a role in all of this work. Now, I use the word performance. I look at the objects, the shapes, the colors, etc. in this work as being performers. They have a relationship to each other. They kind of talk to each other, interact with each other. And they are not, to my way of thinking, related to anything other than their own creation. The Evolution is a series. No images are attached to the framing edge. And I have to correct that, because this painting here, when you align something as close to the framing edge in a long line like that, it attaches itself to the edge. So in a sense, I would say, in my intent, that was a mistake. But I accept it anyway. I have tried to stay away from the edges in order to give the work, not having it tense with the framing edge, to have it float. It is floating. Matter of fact, when I was in school, I was always told, your work is floating. It shouldn't be floating. If these are not floating, then I'm making a mistake. As I say, none of these shapes are referring to anything. They are just shapes. Yes, I intended them to be flat. painted flat. But did I intend them to stay flat on the surface? No. However, that is one way of relating them to the surface, is the flatness. But color itself is not flat. Color bounces, and shape bounces. Size, some of these fall back because they are smaller. Like this is much bigger.
So size.
Right, size. Size is a big factor in the push and the pull of the work on the surface. But yes, I did intend, for example, in this one, I did intend it to be essentially flat. When you do something like that, it stops some of the flatness or pattern. But it is size, color, surface, location that changes where things are. One of the things, for example, that held stained painting together was the fact that it was stained onto the canvas and it soaked into the canvas. And if you look at it, you will see the canvas. You will see the texture of the canvas. And the canvas itself, the material canvas, keeps it flat, but the color allows it to do this, and the sizes, etc. Now, these two paintings over here are a little earlier. And you will note that they touch the framing edge. And from my point of view, that is like a window. And the objects are either up against the window or they are behind the window. One or the other. That was before I moved to move the images further away from the framing edge. This painting, same thing. A kind of an interesting story, I think, about that painting is, again, I am kind of not telling it like it was. The objects in that work, the vertical kind of spirits moving, my wife did those as a drawing. And she did it to give me her impression of what spirit is like leaving Earth. I cut the shapes out later. I put them on a table. And the shape, the black shapes and the drawing between those shapes happened to be on the table. And I looked at it, noticed it, and I thought, that's pretty interesting. I kind of like that. So I decided to do a painting about me and my wife. This was done slightly after her death. But those, to me, represent kind of windows that you are looking at them. I hope the rest of these works you're not so much looking at them, but you're looking through them. You're looking into space. That is stopping space. There is, to my way of thinking, no deep space in that in those works. There is deep space in this work. Each of these paintings developed out of previous work. I photograph my work and I project it, and I rearrange things. And in doing that, I try to give the work a distance to it. At the same time, I want it up here, and I want it out there. And I combine a lot of these things, and I project them on the wall, and I then take pictures of them on the wall, move them around, take them back to the computer. I never thought I would ever, ever use a computer. But I find out I am. Maybe I'm growing up. It definitely has added to the work, without question. It has helped me develop my work. I take them back to the computer and I move them around to get something that I respond to. And then I re-photograph them from the computer. Ultimately, I take them back to the studio. I project them again. And if I think that I am somewhat right, I start to paint. And once I start to paint, many, many changes take place. Because paint doesn't operate like the computer images. I got interested in technology because I was the chairman of the art department. There were faculty who were chomping at the bit. They wanted to get connected to the ongoing world. And as the chairman of the department, it was my responsibility to support them and see what direction it would go. In the same way, I moved interior design into the art department program, which the faculty said didn't belong there, but I decided it did belong there, and I moved it in there. I took trips with the design people to Canada, going to look at buildings, things of that nature, about design, decoration, and so forth, because I felt, as a leader of the program, supporting was part of my responsibility. And as supporting them and helping them, I learned from them the possibilities of the computer and so forth. And my wife did a graduate school, and she did a lot of computer work. And so I gradually got interested in it, and it just developed. I still have to talk to my grandchildren about how do I do this, how do I do that, etc., and to my own children. It has greatly affected my work. It has increased my capabilities. It has helped me actually to become a better non-objective artist. When I went to school, abstract art then back then was called non-objective art. And I think it's too bad that that got dropped, because that is what I want to do. Non-objective, no objects, no still lifes, no landscapes, etc. The computer helped me get over the hump, and I'm very grateful to technology. I think technology has led people in the wrong way sometimes. I think it has, but so has oil paint. oil paint can lead you in the wrong direction as easily as a computer can. But all of that, if you are a sensitive thinking person, all of that becomes a part of you, a part of your work. It becomes a part of your language. It becomes a part of your library. And all the stuff that's on my computer now is part of my library. It plays a big, big role in my work, and I'm grateful. Matter of fact, the most fun to me, the most interest, is actually the painting part. And in this painting, I was looking at the photograph of it the other day, and it speaks of arrangement. If you will notice, this is arranged in a circular motion. It is also arranged in a circular motion there. These two objects relate to each other. And it is kind of crazy. I was looking at this and I said to myself, kind of looks like a football stadium. And the pitcher is there. The first baseman is there. Now, did I intend that to happen? No, I did not. That is not what the painting is about. Painting really is about the shapes, it's about the motion, it's about the way it moves, etc. And there is no real story behind this. And as I said earlier, if you're looking for that in the work, I don't think you'll find it unless you make it up for yourself. And that's okay. The painting that is all the way over there at the end, when Budge came to my studio last year, the kind of dark red shape was a different color and a different structure at that time. And Budge looked at it, and he told me what I was thinking. He said, that looks like a building in a city. And I said, yeah, I know. I've been looking at it, and that I see that too. So as soon as Budge left, I started working on the painting again. I think I improved it. The painting next to that is an unusual, let me tell you, the painting that is on the left, it is ground related in a way. The weight, the gravity of it pulls it down. Yet, I think it still floats in space. This painting is kind of unusual. I have never done a circular painting before. Now, it is not a circle. Part of it is perfect circle. One part of it is smaller than the large circle. It's called light flood. The reason it's called light flood is the way in which light from behind the painting is penetrating it, and it is flooding the circle. That's how it got its name, light flood. I never decide before I do the work. The titling takes place during the process of painting it, and it may change several times as the work changes. And ultimately, I title it with what I feel that it indicates most. For example, that one indicates that it is grounded. It has gravity in it. So I related it to the ground. That one relates to flood. This one does not relate to baseball. This one is called flow. And that is related to the way spirit is flowing. Each one of them has a different name. And do I normally remember them? No. And my family helped me with, and Lori helps me with naming. Basically, names are primarily good simply to know what works are being referred to when somebody writes about the work. Otherwise, it doesn't mean a lot to me. It's like Jack, John, Jill, like my grandchildren, that most of the time I remember their name. I would refer to that one as the circle painting. That would identify it. And when I go to shows in New York, and I come back and I want to communicate about them, I never refer to a title. I say, you know, the big yellow one, or the big blue one. And people will know if they've been to New York which ones I'm referring to, or the ones with stripes, etc. So names don't play for me, and I think for many people, much of a role. I'm often asked, and artists are often asked, how do you know, or do you know, when a work is finished? That is a topic that has been around since I went to art school. in the late 1940s. And it played a really, really big role then. And you probably might guess why. Because abstract expressionism was just beginning to really take fire at that time. So the artists would meet in New York, and they'd spend the whole evening talking about how do you know when the work is finished. I often leave my studio in the evening, and I go upstairs, and I will say to my son, "Well, I finished it tonight." He said, "We'll wait and see." And so in the morning, I go back and I look, and it's not finished. So I finish it again. And I go tell my son, "Well, it's finished this time." And he says, "We'll wait." And he's usually right. Now, in truth, I don't think a work is ever finished. I think it simply moves from one thing to the next one, and then the next one. And then, when it leaves the artist's studio, it changes again. When it leaves the artist's studio, it very often is not about what the artist had in mind at all. It is what the critic says then. It's what the writer says then. And that starts to change what the work is about. And that is, to me, that is very interesting. So the work is never finished. It just keeps on going. I was thinking the other day, it's a little different, but when Picasso painted Gertrude Stein, people would say, "Doesn't really look like her." And Picasso would say, "It will." And what did he mean? Did he mean that she will grow to look like that? I don't think so. I think what he meant was that as the painting gets older and she doesn't exist, everybody will say, "Hey, that's Gertrude Stein." Because it's the painting that takes the place instead of the person. Same thing is with Rembrandt. You look at a Rembrandt and you'll say, "Well, that's a self-portrait." Having lived 90 years, there's been a lot of changes happening in the world. There's been a lot of changes happening in art. And I think if you are a sensitive, tuned in person, you will connect. Now, early on, I connected to abstract expressionism because my teachers did. And that makes a big difference. And some of my teachers had more influence on me than others. One person that you probably have never heard of, had an incredible influence on me. He, because I haven't talked about one aspect of my work, which is spiritual. Spiritual has played a huge role in my work. And how did that happen? It happened in a number of different ways, coming from a number of different directions. When I was in art school, I was reading the book, Kandinsky's book, concerning the spiritual in art. And that was very influential. My teacher, whose name is Ben Bishop, he did teach down at New Paltz for a while. He walked up behind me one time in the studio, and he looked at the work, the painting that I was doing, and he said, "George, that's really a very exciting painting, and I have a name for it." "Oh, what's that?" He said, "That painting should be called Spiritual Journey." I was reading the book concerning the spiritual in art. I grew up in the Bible Belt, Mississippi. I grew up as a Southern Baptist. I don't know that that had much influence on me. It did, but in a different way. I went to a summer camp in Maine, a Jewish girls' camp, and I went to evening services held out under the trees by the lake, and it was a spiritual experience, not a religious experience, a spiritual experience. And there is a difference between the two. Spiritual, and I consider most of these paintings to be spiritually related. Evolution spirit, so that works its way into the work. Now, what does evolution mean in this case? It doesn't mean nature. It doesn't mean human. It means evolution of my work, not the evolution of mankind or the evolution of religion. It's evolution of my work. And spiritual has forever, actually since the day Ben Bishop told me what the name of that painting was. But many teachers don't know how much influence they have, and it is such a simple thing, like simply what he said. It changed my life. And I sometimes wonder, I spent many, many years in the classroom teaching, and I wonder if I ever said something as much as Ben Bishop's statement. One simple statement. And we don't know how much influence we have in so many different ways on people. My granddaughter she wanted to move into my house and live with me when she was 13. And she lived with me until she graduated from high school last year. And we didn't talk much. Teenagers and grown-ups don't talk that much. But we did have a very strong connection. And I started talking about her at a dinner on Sunday night, and how important it was for her to live with me and the effect that it had upon me and so forth. She got up, she grabbed me around the shoulder and started to weep. It changed her too. So That's not about my, well, yes, it is about my work, because all of that is about your work. It's about who you are. It's about your connections, etc. And all of that is very, very important. And very often starts in school.
Here's a question not to ask your professor. And you told me at Yale, you had a student come up to you and they asked, I think they asked, should I be an artist?
Outside the classroom, he said, should I be an artist? I said, no. And he said, how can you be so damn sure? I said, because you had to ask me. If you don't know yourself and you don't already know it, the teacher can't tell you. Had you asked me, do you think I had the talent to be an artist? The answer would have been different. But to ask, say, should I be an artist? If you don't know, the answer is no. My oldest son came to my studio one day, and when he was probably 13, 14, he said, I'm thinking about being an artist. What do you think? Sit down. And I talked to him for 2 hours about what an artist is and what an artist does. He thought it was fun because he saw me working in the studio every day. Looked like a lot of entertainment. But when I finished telling him what really being an artist is, he never mentioned it again.
Sir, will you tell us what that is?
What? Oh.
What
he's asking, so what does it really mean to be an artist? What did you tell him?
It means that you have a connection to something. It means that you have something that you want to say. You may not know early on what it is you want to say. But you have the feeling inside you, knowing that there's something you want to say. And did Southern Baptists have an influence on me? Yes. Because my father was a Sunday school teacher. And I went to church every Sunday. It did change. It did make me aware that I really did have something to say. I didn't know what it was. And I didn't really find out until I got to art school. When I went to school, there was no art in school way back then. I did drawing and that was very important to me. And one of my, an invalid aunt saved my work and praised my work. And that made a difference in my work. But ultimately, I think it's something you want to say. And religion, spirituality, all of that, I hope that I'm still talking about that, that I still have something to say about that. Because if it's not about spirituality, then what is it about?